Okay.
We speak loud, no problem.
No, you don't need to speak loud. I speak loud. Okay. Because they couldn't understand you.
You can send me a ticket.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, thank you. All right. Ready?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I want to thank my host, Lou, to bring me here to China. I'm a bodybuilder for like 30 years, and back in 1991, I was here for the one time with Mr. Bolo Yang. Since 91, all this time, I was looking for a moment I can come back, and actually, moment is just perfect. Best bodybuilder in China wants me to be his coach.
首先他感谢一下如果能请他来中国当教练他已经当30年的职业选手他1991年第一次来中国当时是那个香港那个动作领先杨思请他过来然后他之前一直都想来中国然后这次的机会对于他来说是非常完美的
I come from a very small country, Serbia, in the middle of the Balkans. Nobody in my country ever competed in European Championship, World Championship, no professionals. But when I started bodybuilding, I determined, okay, I have a 5-year goal. I want to win Miss Universe, I'm going to go to America, I'm going to qualify to be IBB pro, I'm going to win some contests so I can qualify for Olympia. I'm going to compete at Olympia and make a living off of bodybuilding. And that was my 5-year plan.
他来自于非常小国家塞尔维亚他刚来美国的时候给自己定了一个五年的计划这五年的计划包括赢下美国先生拿下职业卡获得赢下几场职业赛获得奥林匹亚先生的资格然后通过健美依靠健美为生这是他当年五年的计划而且他也做到了
So nobody in my country was supportive. Everybody was, you're gonna compete against these people? We have no chance, right? My father raised me to believe that we are all human beings from the same flesh and blood. I'm not inferior or superior to you, none of you, right? I just did all the work that it takes to be a top professional bodybuilder. So each and one of you could be at this Olympia stage, guaranteed. It's just how bad you want it.
在他的城市塞尔维亚他去美国的时候没有任何人支持他但是他的父亲告诉他说人都是平等人就是人没有谁比谁更高级没有谁比谁更低级他只是做了他所需要做的所有事情所以说他成为了顶级职业健身运动员就是在座的各位只要把该做的都做了都会有可能去在像奥林匹亚先生这种级别的舞台上竞技
And I'm not telling you this to bullshit you and just try to encourage you. I'm telling you this from the heart. I've done it and I've seen hundreds of people from all over the world do it. It's just hard work and knowledge.
他说他这个不是那种搜的心灵鸡汤或者说去刻意的鼓励大家他自己做到他的很多客户也做到所以说只要把该做的事情做到就是可以
Now hard work. In the last 7-8 days, right? You see me train Lou. You guys watch every single workout. If this is not the hard work, I don't know what it is. Right? This is extreme, intense, brutal. And he did it. I just came to China, I didn't prepare him. And first day, immediately, boom, 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 everything, right? So after like 10-12 workouts, you see him getting bigger and better and stronger. This is hard work, but you have to have it here and here.
就是大家都看到师傅每天锻炼，我每天训练，如果说这种训练都算不上努力的话，那他米老师他也不知道什么叫努力。就是说他从第一天到中国没有做任何的铺垫，一上来就是上强度，然后每一次训练都要练到极致。 然后这样，其实大家也看到，在这已经练了10到12次，10到12次，大概2个半循环之后，那时候进步是非常明显的，就肌肉的增长非常明显的。
So I'm going to talk about the training later, But before training, what I think is the most important, especially for most of you because you're dieting for the contest, it's about the diet.
除了训练的细节，他待会儿会讲一些，但他觉得最重要的，尤其对在备赛的各位来讲，是营养饮食方面。You
just have to really understand the basic human physiology and the rules apply in nutrition.
现在需要你们先理解的就是人体一个最基本的原理，人体是如何进行行属功能的一个原理，以及这个最基础的一个热量需求的一个标准。So
number one priority in life in your body is energy. Without energy, life is impossible. So energy is always number one priority.
身体内，人的身体内，生命的第一需求就是能量。所以说，在一个人身体内，获取能量永远是放在第一位。And
from energy, nutrients, you guys know that we have a protein, carbohydrates, and fat. They're all delivering energy. 1 gram of protein, 4 calories, and 1 gram of carbohydrates, 4, and 1 gram of fat, 9 calories.
那说到能量，就牵扯到不同的营养素。不同的营养素有蛋白质、碳水和脂肪。那一克蛋白质有4大卡热量，一克碳水有4大卡热量，一克的脂肪有9大卡热量。So,
carbohydrates and fat are only energy nutrients, only deliver energy, nothing else. But protein is a building material and also can deliver energy. So only protein can do both. These cannot build your body.
碳水和脂肪的功能只是单纯去供能，但是蛋白质呢，它既可以供能，同时它也是提供氨基酸构建身体的一个材料。所以说，只有蛋白质同时具有构建身体跟供能的两方面的功能。
So, when we determine how much calories you need, how much blue means me, you, right? Okay, it goes with the What is daily caloric requirement, really, for you to survive? Now, first, you start with the basic metabolic rate. This is your body in a state of coma. You're sleeping, right? But still, energy is needed when you're sleeping because heart, right? Without energy, heart stops. Lungs, brain, you know, enzymes, everything is needed, you know, for survival. So basic physiological needs is BMR. And how do they determine BMR? It's by a Harris-Benedict formula. That's a very good medical formula. Don't want to confuse you. Harris-Benedict, okay? But you have easy on the internet. It's called BMR calculator. And with this calculator, you put your age, yeah, 31, for a loop, gender, male, height, 6'5"? 6'5". 6'5", yeah? 6'5". Oh, I've been putting on my Instagram 6'5". Okay, and weight, 130 kilos, right? So, okay, translate.
说到现在要确定一个人所需的能量，就是每一个不同个体所需的能量的时候， 就牵扯到一个最基础的一个代谢，那这个 BMR 意思就是basic metabolism rate， 就是基础代谢效率。那基础代谢效率是什么意思呢？就是说，你一个人躺那儿不动，或者说直接昏迷了，昏迷一天所消耗的能量。那这为什么还会消耗能量？是因为你的器官、你的大脑、你的心脏、你的肺，在你睡着或者昏迷的时候，它 依然是在做功的，依然是需要能量。那这个东西怎么去获得这个数据呢？它上面写的那个是一个国外的一个计算器，就是计算那个BMR的一个，就是说，它类似于一个网站，然后你输进去你的身高、性别、年龄，就可以得到这个数据。但其实咱们国内也有这种就是所谓的 BMR 计算器，只要百度一下都有。
And if you go on your phone right now, BMR calculator, and put this number, you're going to get about 2,550, I think, calories per day needed for Lu Chen Hui to be in a state of coma.
就比如说现在上网找一个 BMR 计算器，那得到的把所有数据输进去以后，得到这个数值就是师傅天天躺着昏迷的所需要消耗的能量。
You see, in America, in the hospitals, if you're in a coma, they have to infuse you with the caloric intake and nutrients equivalent to that to maintain life.
就是说，在美国的话，如果一个植物人他天天睡着不动，他需要去输液，把营养物质通过输液输进身体的话，那这个数值就是他每天真正就是通过这个液体所摄入的能量。
Now, for daily caloric requirement, you take his basic metabolic rate and then add thermic effect of exercise, everything physical. That everything that he does, training, cardio, if he does some, you know, whatever, boxing, kung fu, swimming, blah, blah. That's exercise, thermic effect of exercise. That's the physical activity. And as I'm his coach, 2 times a day training, 2 times cardio.
这个 TEE 就是一个你运动的热效应。运动热效应包括什么呢？包括力量训练，包括有氧，包括你比如说打篮球、去拳击，所有的东西都包括在内。那这个那对于师傅来说，他的这个运动的，就是运动的热效应是什么呢？就是两次力量，两次有氧，就是纯粹的一个体力的消耗。
So you've seen the intensity of the workout. You train for about an hour and a half, and everything I put him through. What do you estimate how many calories these burns? You can ask them.
刘老师问大家，就是大家觉得像他这种训练模式，每次一个半小时，一次训练大概能消耗多少卡路里？
In one workout.
就是一次力量训练。
700 calories.
Good. Yeah, I would say between say 750 to 1,000.
说他觉得应该在750到1,000.
Yeah. With this kind of intensity, I mean heavy. Giant sets no rest. You know he's breathing or you know shit. He is. I mean if you go on the internet and you now put their energy requirement for vacuuming, 1 hour, 600 calories.Ironing the clothes, 500 calories, bullshit, right? This is, so imagine 2 times a day, and then 2 times cardio. Now cardio, also it should be 400 to 700 calories an hour. As they're going a little bit slower, let's become like 400 to 500. 500 to be easy to calculate. So now that's 1,000 and 2,000.So 3,000, so he's already at 5,550 calories a day, right?
现在他是在大概算一下这个每天，就说单纯的身体在基础代谢效率跟这个运动热效应所消耗的一个能量，就说他像师傅这种训练，每天这种就说气儿都喘不上来的这种强度，大概是在750到1,000卡，那有氧因为。做的相对慢一点，大概是在400到700卡，那他折中取500卡，那这样算下来，两次力量，两次有氧的话，再加上每天的基础代谢效率，就已经消耗了5,550大卡的热量。
So, thermic effect of feeding all the food that you eat, if it's a chicken, turkey, fish, you know, whatever you take, everything has to be broken down.Assimilated, absorbed, eliminated, right? So this is also caloric expenditure right here. And it usually accounts for like about 10% on top of it. With protein when you eat, it's about 30% TF, right? Green leafy vegetables, yeah, it can be 50 plus. You've heard about negative calories, right? Because it's fiber.Body tries to digest, but it cannot. And fat is very low, like less than 10. But the thermic effect of feeding it adds more, so they're gonna add plus 500 calories.
这个 TES 就是进食的热效应，就是说什么意思呢？就是每天吃进去的所有食物，大概就是碳水、脂肪、纤维素这些东西，它在消耗过程中都会消耗能量。那不同的营养物质，它在消耗的分解过程中所消耗的能量是不同的。那蛋白质可能要多消耗 30%， 那消耗最多的就所谓的，例如说蔬菜是负卡路里食物，就是说它。 在分解过程中，它会消耗 50%， 那脂肪最少，它只会多消耗 10%。 那把这个进食的热效应也算下来，那每天的这个热量消耗是要再多加上 500大卡。
And this is the additional one. You just like okay, like for him, he ruled like this, right? So pastoral change that he would, you know, stand like this for hours a day. These kind of things contribute to. Some additional energy requirement.
This X 就是说一个不确定量，比如说你每天习惯的是这样，工作要做的。那当你停息要做的时候，你这样就单纯这样坐着，消耗能量会变多的，这就是一个不确定的因素。那
TEF 是每天的摄入热量总热量
，TEF 是进食热效应
TEF 啊。
进食热效应就是说你吃东西分解这些食物所需要多余的热量。Any
question?
Okay.
Okay. So here is like visual, so you can understand. If right now, if I took Lou for example, right? Right now he is a counter shape. No body fat to lose, zero, right? I would be able to put him 5,500 calories, right? And he's not gonna lose, he's not gonna gain, right? This is 5,500 is requirement. Right? But now, in this conscious preparation, we need to lose a little bit of body fat. So what do? We do the caloric deficit, right? So we create caloric deficit. And then I'm going to explain you. I would like to use him as example, the 95 kilo guy. It's again, so you can see. But here is for Lou. If first day he eats like okay, only 4,500 calories, right? First day, and then he goes here, for example, and here, and then he goes here, and then decides to go here, and so on. That's a 2,000 calorie deficit. This is 1,000 calorie deficit, 1,000 calorie. So every day when it's a deficit, where do those calories come from? Yeah? Where do they come from? Translate.
Yeah. I haven't translated the first part.
Okay.
Don't even understand this.
You didn't understand?
No, they did not answer, I didn't translate it yet. 他现在说的这个意思就是拿食物举了个例子，就是说如果说已经是在备赛，就是说结束状态下，已经是上台的状态下，那这5500卡热量就是每天吃5500卡，然后保持训练的话，既不会增加肌肉，也不会减少肌肉。那现在为了多减掉点脂肪，就要这个有一个热量赤字。 那热量赤字，比如说第一天吃到4500卡，第二天吃到比4500卡再少一点，然后一直吃到3500卡左右，那这个中间就产生了一个2000大卡的热量赤字。那这个热量赤字来源于哪呢？这是他的一个问题，就是让大家回答一下。就说这些热量，这些缺少的热量是从哪来的？ 当然是从你的脂肪消耗功能得到的。Is
that fat and does that come from fat? Right, fat. Yeah, well, that's what we would like to know. This is, in this world, that would be so easy to diet, right? So here's how it goes. If you talk money, today I need to give you $5,500. But I give you only $4,500. Where is thousand other coming from? It's gonna go from the bank. So here it is. Here is the food. Today you need the $5,500, but you only eat $4,500 Monday. Okay, 1,000 is missing. 1,000 calories is missing. Where is it coming from? Okay, so food is gone. Now 1,000 calories have to come from the body. Okay? So we would like fat to give us these calories. Then life would be easy. But when there's a high caloric deficit, that doesn't happen. Because fat, to exist in your body, 1 pound takes only like 9 calories in a day. Muscle under your skin, minimum 69 calories inactive muscle per day. So if your body needs to save, 1,000 calories, get rid of the fat, it just spares few calories, so it destroys the muscle. So the greater the deficit, the more muscle loss.
因为食物已经完全被消耗光了，但是事实上，如果在存在一个正大的热量缺口情况下，身体它是不会去直接分解脂肪的，但可能会分解一点脂肪。但是因为身体保存每一磅肌肉所需要的热量，就是说不活跃的肌肉所需要的热量是69大卡。 那保存每一磅脂肪所需要的热量才是9大卡，所以说对于身体来说，它把这个脂肪消耗掉了以后，它能提供的，就是说它能提供能量的效率是非常低的。但是它如果把肌肉消耗掉了，那就意味着它把整体的代谢会降低更多，它就可以更适应这个低卡路里的饮食。所以说，其实这个。
过度的热量赤字越大的话，它消耗的脂肪，消耗的肌肉就越多。
Okay, what is his name? Alo. Alo. Okay, his diet, right? If he can repeat to me how much calories he's taking? 他让你说一下你每天吃大概多少卡的热量？现在，对，就是现在吃的。我吃100克至200克之间。
About 100 to 150 gram of protein and 50 gram of carbs.
Okay. So the 650 gram of carbs is 200. Okay. So look, he is under 1,000 calories a day.
就是他每天这样吃字比1000大卡都要多。Okay.
If you calculate your BMR, it's going to for sure be minimum 2,000 BMR.
如果算一下基础代谢效率,
exercise,
至少也要有2000大卡。
Exercise, 2 times a day and 2 cardio?
他们是一天练两练，然后两次有氧。但是力量强度没有那么大。
OK, if you train like a baby, it's going to be another 2,000. You know,
就是,
yeah.
然后这个强度不大, 两次力量，两次有氧也会消耗至少两千大卡热量。
You know, 400, 400, 800, and training 600, 600 every day. That's 4,000 calories, and he's eating less than 1,000. That's a 3,000 calorie deficit.
3,000大卡热量赤字。
So here it is. He's supposed to take 4,000.
本来应该吃4,000大卡。
Okay, first day, Monday, and then Tuesday, and then Wednesday, and then Thursday.Right? Your body is in starvation mode. It's trying to survive. And when it's trying to survive, it tries to get rid of the tissue that causes a lot of caloric expenditure, which is muscle tissue. So he's going to start shutting down his metabolism to survive on this.
就是说，比如说下面是星期一、星期二、星期三、星期四、星期五、星期六。然后，比如说第一天开始就开始吃1,000卡，就中间有3,000卡热量赤字，那身体就进入到一个求生模式。求生模式什么意思呢？就身体会把，它会倾向于去把肌肉都分解掉，这样它需要的能量就变少了。所以说它慢慢就适应这个一千卡的摄入，那就意味着你的整体的代谢效率在受损，你的这个身体的代谢越来越低，越来越低，越来越低，最后就变成。你的这个能保持的这个热量的值就变成了一个1,000卡，就不是以前的4,000卡。
Yep. So, the reason why I'm telling you this is because I'm sure it happened to you year after year after year. You die for the contest, you shut down your metabolism, and then you start eating and you're poof. Well, sorry, Rick, I can use you for example too. He was competing 3 weeks ago, right?And now he gained weight. Why? I competed 110 times. 72 times as a pro, I was always in shape because I always follow these principles. Okay.
他们说这个其实就是能解释为什么比完赛稍微一吃人就肥了。比如说像我这样，我3个星期以前比完，然后现在胖成这个样子。然后就是因为你的这个代谢已经受损了。受损了以后，你热量再一吃，它身体就立马就等于你每天多吃了3,000-4,000卡的热量，所以说它立马就全变成脂肪了。
So today, if he eats this, good, he doesn't gain, he doesn't lose. Tomorrow, but 2 months after, when he is dieting, he says, forget about diet. Now I'm just gonna eat my normal food because this is I don't gain, I don't lose.Well, now, this is 3,000 calories more than his metabolism, and this is all going to be stored right into the body fat.
这个意思就是，本来4,000卡是一个维持水平，就吃了以后，既不会增长体重，也不会减少体重。那你按照1,000卡每天的摄入，你节食了，就是说控制饮食了2个月。这2个月以后，比如说比完赛，突然觉得，那我就正常吃吧。你一正常吃就多出了3,000卡热量盈余，那这3,000卡热量盈余它就立马就变成脂肪了。
Okay, so my principle, what I use always with all my athletes, and what I'm using now with Mr. Lu, and what I would always suggest to everyone, right? Okay, it depends how much time you have for a contest, and if you have a 3 weeks and you're fat, then you have to do some extreme. Yes.But I'm going to talk about ideal case scenario. Ideally.
他现在要讲的就是在一个理想的状况下去备赛的时候饮食是怎么样的。当然说比如说还有3周就要比赛了，然后但是体脂还很高，那肯定要采取极端的措施。大家现在讲的就是一个理想状态下如何在保存最大程度的保存肌肉，同时出比赛状态的一个饮食。所以他的所有的客户都是这样，他都是这样计划。
So this is how it is. Let's say this is 1 week. Okay. I look at my athlete and I see now, you know, for example, for Lu, I want him to improve, you know, big time chest, right? So, oh, okay, on that chest there, let's say, you know,chest day, I'm going to say for a high calorie day. We still need to lose body fat. So now, Monday, Tuesday, I'm going to go down maybe 1,000 calories deficit, right? Tuesday, maybe a little bit less, 750. On Wednesday, boom, I can go right above, right? Thursday, I'm going to go again 1,000. Friday, if I have to be aggressive, 1,000. Saturday, I'm going to go right here. Examples, right? So when you keep smaller deficit and you are going this, right? In this case, body doesn't shut down. You don't have a flat line. So you go high, you confuse the body.
这个图表意思就是说，他是拿15现在备赛举例子，因为比如说周三这练胸，那他想提升胸部的这个上胸的厚度跟宽度，所以说周三这一天是高卡路里的一天。那同时还是需要减少皮脂，那减少皮脂，比如说在周一、周二，他每一天都控制着有一定的热量赤字，但是他不是说一下降了很低，或者说一直保持在很低，它有一个曲线。 那这样的曲线就会让你的身体有一个迷惑感，就像阿诺说的，让身体不能猜到你的干啥，所以说现在它的代谢效率就不会去直接的越来越低，所以说这种曲线是一个最健康的去备赛的一个热量的一个安排。
Okay, and before I say anything else, I want to understand. I see the pictures of Mr. Liu on a competition, and his level of conditioning is mind-boggling. This was better than Mr. Olympia winner, right? So for me, I have an utmost respect for any bodybuilder that was self-taught, and he accomplished this kind of condition. So you have to, you know, tell us. It's tremendous, and you know, you were in very good shape, and the whole team, right? But the difference that I want to, you know, bring it, I want that kind of conditioning that we achieve, but maintain more muscle so we don't catabolize. When you catabolize, it's very hard to, you know, bring it up once you start carb loading and everything, because your metabolism is shut.
他先在就是说，在他继续讲之前，他想强调一点是，说看了是不是去年和前年的照片，包括陆家文其他的成员比赛的照片，那个肌肉状态是非常好的，就甚至说比真正奥赛上的选手都要好，就很干。他非常尊重就是通过这种很刻苦的训练跟有氧，把这个肌肉状态调整得很好的一些运动员。但他现在要做的是，就是保证肌肉不要受损。 身体不进入分解代谢模式，同时把之前的那种肌肉状态再次做出来，就是在，但是是建立在保存住更多的肌肉的前提下。
So these kind of things you're doing, if you have a 6, 8, 10, 12, 16 weeks, so if you're a little bit more fat, right, and you are competing 16 weeks, okay, you start now. Initially, deficit, you know, doesn't need to be that big. But then as you go, okay, now I need a little bit more, or, you know, 2 days low, 1 high, 3 days low, 1 high.
就是说，这个曲线应用在什么地方？比如说在赛前的10到16周，那比如说你时间是充裕的话，那你在一开始的时候，热量赤字可能不需要那么大，或者说就说你安排热量的次数不需要那么多，就说保证有一个高低的一个交替就行。
Yeah, but if you do every day the same diet, because every day the same diet, it's then a flat line. Then present metabolism goes down to the newly shut down metabolism.
但是说，如果每天都吃一样的低热量，就意味着你现在的这个基础代谢水平会逐渐降低，降低到你吃的这个热量水平，这样你的代谢效率就受损了。
Okay, so now how do I structure the diet?
现在就是要教大家如何去安排这个饮食。And
again, please explain them. I competed 110 times, right? This is a non-stop competition.
他职业生涯一共比过110场比赛，而基本上都是不停的，一直都在比。
Okay, 24 hours a day. I always like to have three different phases, right? I like to have an anabolic phase to build muscle. Fat burning phase. Okay. To lose fat. And then the rest of the day is maintenance. So, as soon as you wake up, right, after like so many hours of sleeping, you didn't eat anything, right? So there's no nutrients, no glucose, no amino acids, no triglycerides floating around. You do the cardio on empty stomach right here. Cardio. 100%, 1,000,000% guarantee you're going to burn fat.
就是说你每天早上起来，因为睡了这么长时间，身体所有的药物都消耗光了，你身体没有什么氨基酸，没有什么葡萄糖，所以说在这个时候你去做空腹的有氧，100%，甚至说1,000%的，你消耗的都是脂肪。So
do you understand that, right?
大家这个理解一下。Cardiovascular
activity, what you do, uses fat as a fuel. Training, right, uses glucose. Aerobic uses fat. So you didn't eat anything, you didn't take no amino acids, nothing. 100% for sure it has to come from a body.
就是说这种空腹有氧呢，它是通过脂肪供的，那力量训练是糖原供的。那像一般的那种有氧运动，比如说去游泳啊啥的，这个就是它还是 糖原跟脂肪同时供应，所以说一定要理解，这个阶段是完完全全的一个减脂的阶段。If
this is not making it lose your fat fast enough, we add another one, like we're doing now with Mr. Lu, another hour here.
如果说单纯早上做有氧，不能体脂减的还不够快的话，那我们在这个睡前再
Jay Cutler sometimes did like 3 hours of cardio, but I heard that Lou did even 5 or 8.
Yeah? But
you know, from present day, this is the next day. If this happens already, you lost body fat in two occasions, right? Okay, now we train 2 times a day, and that's when we're creating anabolic phase.
He's asking a question, you know, what if we do cardio immediately after the session?
It's okay, but I'll tell you this. They interviewed me back in 1990, like, when is the best time to do the cardio? So I was under belief, right, it doesn't matter, you do the cardio at any point, you know, that's the same thing, same calories are being used. And then they showed me the study from university that if you do on empty stomach, really, it's about 30% rate. You know, so since then, I would always like to do it first thing in the morning, okay? The second part it could be effective is immediately after the training. Because if you're training with no carbs, you're depleting, and then immediately, you know, doing a cardio is good. But if you are in an anabolic phase and I have you drink all these carbs, then I would not want you to do the cardio after training. So, ideally, it's like empty stomach is number one, post-workout on depleted state number two, and then late at night, like a couple of hours after the meal containing no carbs.
他说的有两部分，第一部分就是说他在九几年的时候，他是不相信说你什么时候做有氧都行，他当时觉得。 但是他看了一个大学的一个大学的一个研究报告，那研究报告就是说，如果是在空腹早晨起来空腹情况下做的话，他这个有氧代谢的效率提升30%。然后他在此之后，他就是一直相信，也是说他给他所有的客户安排的也都是在这个早晨起来做有氧。那至于说这个训练后做有氧，训练后做有氧是不是更好呢？这个取决于你训练中的补剂的摄入，因为他米老师的理论，他在训练中的补剂的摄入，比如说你在有胰岛素有用胰岛素的时候，或者说在这个练腿的这个五四的这个训练中，它多多少少都会有这个糖原的补充的，有氨基酸的补充的。你就意味着，如果说你在喝这些补剂，你在训练的过程中，你在喝这些补剂，你在训练结束的时候，你身体是没有处在一个像你早上起来那种身体里没有任何营养物质状态。那时候，这个时候你再去做有氧，你消耗是身体这些营养物质，你没有在直接消耗脂肪。那什么情况下，在训练后做有氧效率更高呢？就是说你在训练的过程中，你什么都没有吃，没有喝，没有任何补剂的补充。然后你身体进入到一个就说把糖原完全代谢干净的一个状态，这时候去做有氧效率是更高的。
Okay, now I want to think of this. If you give body everything the body needs, enough protein, enough carbs, enough fat, right? All day it's running perfectly. Nothing's going to be stored. You have enough energy, you use the energy. Okay.If you have too much energy, carbs, okay, it can be stored in the glycogen storage if glycogen is empty. If glycogen is full, excess carbs can be converted to fat. If you have too much fat, same thing, it's going to go to the fat. You know, so ideally, when you know how much you're supposed to eat and you structure a diet, you're supposed to have an ideal like this, but we create a deficit.So we lower this too.
他是说，这个理想情况下，我们人每天就是应该就是算好一个碳水、蛋白还有脂肪的摄入，然后保证这种摄入情况下呢，身体既不会去储存脂肪，也不会去过度消耗什么。但是如果你碳水吃的过多，那这部分多余的碳水呢，它首先会补充成糖原，那糖原被补充完整补充糖原补充完成以后，那剩下还有多余的就变成脂肪。同样，脂肪也是一个道理，脂肪摄入过多，它就也会去转换成脂肪。那现在这种备赛饮食，我们想要做到是一个什么状态呢？就是说，你三种营养素是算好的，但是把这个供能的两种。碳水跟脂肪量稍微降一点，就意味着你有一个不是特别大的一个热量赤字，这样就会去比较能比较高效的去减少脂肪。
Yeah, but now for us is a bodybuilder. Thank you so much. Good, thank you. I'm gonna get it. Caffeine number one. So protein, carbohydrates, and fat. Look, what is the most important for us bodybuilders?What is the most important?
现在问大家，蛋白质、碳水、脂肪，哪一种是对于健美运动员来说最重要的？
Okay, so if you read the medical books, they're going to give you some bullshit of 1 gram, you know, per pound is enough. No, I go with the 4 grams per kilo.
就是说，如果说去看那些什么医学的研究，会说，每磅体重一克蛋白质就够了，但是他的建议是每公斤体重摄入4克的蛋白质。
So in his case, it's almost 400 grams a day. But he needs only 100 to 200.
就说像阿文师兄的话，就应该是一天在400克左右。
Now protein, yeah, protein, and that's only 4 calories, right? Per gram. So 400 is only 1600 calories.
就一克的脂肪才是400卡热量，所以说。400克的刚说错了，一个蛋白质才是4大卡热量，那400克的蛋白质才只有1600大卡热量，
很低。是每公斤肌肉还是体重？
体重。
Yeah. Protein is only building nutrient for whole body, not just muscle. hair and skin and bone and enzymes, hormones, everything is made out of protein, right? So what we want is throughout the whole 24 hours a day, enough protein, amino acids for everyone around, right? We want constant influx of protein.
这个蛋白质是唯一的一个构建功能一样物质，那这个构建功能并不单单是在构建肌肉，那你的头发、你的器官、你的身体的激素全部都是由氨基酸要参与构成。所以说理想状态下，我们是要让一天之中这个蛋白质摄入始终是充足的，氨基酸的血液中氨基酸的含量始终是充足的，就是要把这些摄入分散在每一天的饮食里面。
Okay, and what you want to do is to have as many different sources of protein, like egg protein in the beginning, fish in the second meal, chicken, beef, and then you rotate.
就是理想状态下，这些蛋白质的来源应该是在不断变化。比如说，第一顿是吃蛋白，第二顿吃鱼，第三顿吃鸡肉，第四顿吃牛肉，这样就是，然后这个顺序也可以去，就是说变化比较多。
Okay. So what happens now when you go super low carbs, like 50 grams of carbs a day? So let's say you have a 50 grams of carbs in the morning, right?
早，您五十克碳水是什么？也是。就是三顿活动啊。Three meals, 15, 15, 15. 15 meals, 15, 15, 15.
Yeah. So that means four rice.
就说一点点。
Okay. So, this is going to be like fire is burning. Which means this little bit of carbohydrates that you have is gone.
这就是说一段那一口吃下去啪就没了，没了以后就是你身体在这个一天进行之中，它还是需要。
In your warm up, it's gone before you even start training.
就我还没开始练的那个碳水就已经消耗掉了。Brain
uses 500 calories, 125 grams of glucose a day. Brain.
就说光这个人的大脑每天就要消耗五百大卡，一般125克左右的这个葡萄糖。But
now 50 grams of carbs a day is gone, okay? And his fat intake is almost nothing, very low. Yeah, triglycerides, very, very low. What did they say? Energy is number one priority for the body. Not muscle. Muscle is not priority. Okay? So energy is needed. All these amino acids here. Now, instead of putting it in the muscle, now protein has to be converted into the carbs. Protein has 20 amino acids, 18 amino acids are glycogenic. So there is a process called gluconeogenesis that converts these 18 glycogenic aminos into the glucose instantly, like this. So instead of having a protein that can be integrated into the muscle, now because you have so little carbs, this protein is converting to give you that energy and gives you the glucose.
就是说现在如果吃五十克的碳水发生的是什么情况，就是说五十克碳水很快就消耗掉了，然后这个饮食中也没有什么脂肪，基本上没有脂肪，就导致你身体，就是他一开始讲的身体的首要的一个倾向是去，最主要的它是要保持能量的供给，那这个能量供给现在是脂肪没有，碳水也没有，那它从哪来呢？就是它这些蓝色这些点记的就是，意思就是。 蛋白质分解以后产生的氨基酸，然后这个蛋白质分解产生的氨基酸有20种，这20种氨基酸里面有18种是可以转化成糖原的，然后有一个化学过程，就是这个糖氨基酸转化成糖原的一个过程。那这种18种氨基酸呢，它就无法进入细胞去构建肌肉，它就被转化成碳水来供能了。Okay,
now, does this make sense? Does this make sense so far?
就是说现在讲到这儿，大家觉得这个说得通吗？
Yes. Okay. Then the question is, then why they choose to lower it so dramatically?
那就你们备赛时候为啥还要吃那么少
？Like you, I don't know. You have a phenomenal physique.
Oh my God.
Yeah. You see, but I think with a correct diet, you should be so much bigger and just as lean.
吃的对的话，其实可以大脂很多，但是还是可以降的。因为我们是想要快速的出状态嘛，在赛前就感觉这个状态要体现出来，可能平时体脂有点高，所以说我们肯定不是要减少蛋白质摄入，那肯定是压榨的是脂肪，就我们基本上在赛季的话，就不会摄入这个牛油，就是比方说橄榄油或者说花生油。 我们只摄入一些不饱和脂肪酸以及牛肉、鸡肉里面的原始的那个饱和脂肪酸，就不会摄入牛油了。然后的话，碳水会压榨很多。但是我们相信，有足够的煤体和浓足够多的话，就可以保护肌肉。在低量热量的时候保护肌肉，所以说我们碳水吃的特别少。
I'm saying that the strategy that they apply to the contest prep is because we believe in off season our group will be heavy, a little bit fat, but now it's our contest prep, right? So we lower the fat, lower the carbs, and we have to push ourselves. But we still believe certain steroids like testosterone or premium or train access would actually help us maintain that much muscle. That is our belief. So we believe that it doesn't matter the energy deficiency is there, but taking so much stuff.
Yes. This is nutritional manipulation. Nutritional. Not pharmacological.
从单纯营养学的角度来讲这个比赛，还没有讲到这个从药物角度来讲。
You are correct. Yes, that's why we take.
说的是对的。
That's why we take anabolic steroids.
为啥我们要打药？We
take anabolic steroids because what is anabolism? Anabolism is constructive metabolism, right? Not destructive. So it builds, increases protein synthesis, right? So steroids are saving you. Yes.
我们打药的目的就是因为这个类固醇，它可以提升人的这个蛋白质合成的效率，可以让我们的身体代谢增高，这就是我们为啥要用它。But
imagine what would happen if you take same amount of steroids, but you don't make nutritional mistakes.
但是想象一下，如果说我们用同样剂量类固醇，但是我们的营养部分也做到位，两边都做到位的话。
Yeah, you just leave a little bit more time for a contest prep. And as soon as you finish this next competition, I would really suggest you stay in shape. Don't get out of the shape, right? The best time to grow is immediately after the show. What did I say about Lou? After the October 23rd, he's going to grow to the next show. Because when your body fat is gone, then I can up the calories and give you all, you know, no deficit. Now he's in deficit. Then he's gonna be no deficit. Then he grow and grow and grow. So, just to tell you, Daniel James, 44 pounds, 20 kilos a month. Michael Struve, 42 kilos in 1 month. Gustavo Badel, 17. Then it's all better. Yeah. This is how much they gain.
How do I explore the show? 他的计划都是把这个营养和药物两方面都做到位，就意味着备赛的这个时间最好留得长一点，而且同时他建议是说在比完赛以后，最好的方法是你保持住自己的状态，然后在这时候开始增肌，那这个原理是什么呢？就是你在比完赛以后，你身体的皮脂很少很少，那我们在备赛过程中，它身你这个营养摄入是有热量赤字的，所以说它并不是在完全的。 促进肌肉增长，那你当你现在比完赛，你现在不需要有热量赤字，因为你皮脂已经到位，所以说你就可以提升你的热量，然后同时一步一步的像下一，比如说下场比赛4周以后，那就可以直接在这4周内，就说在备赛同时越来越大，就说不断在增加肌肉。像他有一些运动员，像那个丹斯詹姆斯，还有那个布斯塔沃巴德尔，那个就是他在备完赛以后的一个月。 一个月之内可以增长15到20公斤的体重， 15到20公斤的体重。
当然这个是肯定是用不了的。Yeah. So, by all means, I'm going to say, yes, you can get an incredible shape over dieting. But that's what I think I mentioned when we talked. I've seen Malaysian, you know, Filipino, Japanese bodybuilders. They compete for 20 years, and they're staying in the same category. 70 kilo, 70 kilo, 70 kilo, 70 kilo, 1985, 70 kilo, 2005.
就是他就说他带过的亚洲人的男挺多的，就是其实他见过很多日本的，包括马来西亚这种人，比一辈子他就是75公斤。就是因为你过度的节食，确实会能把状态做出来，但是你长不了呀，你长不了肌肉啊。所以说这可能是我们可能是亚洲人的一种心态或者说什么，但是其实这样是不好的。
Okay, so what is number one thing that all the bodybuilders, what do we want?
说现在他问大家一个问题，就是我们作为健身运动员，最想要的是什么？大。Anabolism, right?
Now, the steroids, right, is gonna prevent muscle loss. Prevent muscle loss. Under calorically, but no, not enough. It cannot make you grow. So, it increases protein synthesis, yes, but there is not enough protein. So how can it happen?
他会说，确实我们的第一要目标就是要变大。但是说，我们比如说我们用类固醇，这个类固醇它的一个最基本功能就是说，在有热量赤字的前提下，它能保存住我们的肌肉。但是你没有一个热量的合适的热量，你保存是能保存，但你长不了。长不了就意味着你没有肌肉的合成。所以说，你如果说 打了药，但是没有吃够，它还是不会长的。Increased
protein synthesis leads to anabolic state. Increased protein degradation to catabolic state. So protein synthesis is plus. Let's say you make plus 5. Hey, but then protein degradation is minus 5. Result is 0.
他说的意思就是，比如说我们第一行，就比如说我们用药。 产生的提升的你的这个蛋白质合成效率，比如说就是所谓合成代谢的效率，比如说我们增加了5%。那第二行就是说我们有热量赤字导致的这个蛋白质消耗的一个效率，比如说减少5%，那这增加5%减少5%的价值是没有的，那所以说你的肌肉量不会产生变化。
So, here we come now to the anabolic phase, which I want you to understand. Normally, exercise physiology is a science if you read in the book. With that, you eat an hour and a half before training, you go there, train intensely, you break down the muscle fiber, you lose ATP, cellular energy, you lose glycogen, you create micro tears and muscle fibers, right? So you deplete, create damage, and then after, when you eat, body is slowly pulling to replenish what you have lost. So in other words, you create catabolism, and then body's gonna slowly, you know, try to anabolize it, providing you have all the nutrients, providing you have a sufficient amount of calories.
对，他现在讲的就是一个我们锻炼的为什么肌肉会增长的一个基本原理，就是说我们去力量训练，把身体里的营养物质慢慢都消耗完了，消耗完了以后，你给身体一个信号，就是说我现在需要开始补充了。 那因为你消耗的非常，比如说训练的可能很消耗非常彻底，那身体会有过度补充的趋势，这些营养物质再进到身体里以后，它就促进了一个肌肉的生长。Okay,
so let's analyze this. This is what do we want to accomplish when we train? Why do I give him giant sets, super slow, fast, explosive, static, you know, isotension? Different. I'm trying to create as much different stimulation, right, to the maximum amount of muscle fibers of his targeting muscle group, right? But also, I want to deliver all the anabolic, anti-catabolic, fat-burning nutrients in that muscle. So, I want everything, because here is training, that's it. Here is his hour and a half of training.
就是说 明老师刚刚说为什么他训练要这么狠，要使用这些各种的技巧，什么缓慢控制、过度拉伸、过度收缩、巨人组、超级组，为什么要用这些？其实归根结底他的一个目的就是去产生最大化的刺激，但只是这只是一方面，另一方面他要做到的就是说要让你身体里所有这些合成代谢的物质，就是说或者说可以抵抗分解代谢的物质，所有的营养物质都能在你训练的这个过程中进入细胞，这样就会让你训练的效率最大化。
OK, this is my system. OK, we all have a 5-6 liters of blood. Right now, when you're sitting here doing nothing, maybe 10, maybe 5% of the blood is in the muscle. Because you're doing this, and he's doing this, and real blood goes to the finger. You know, it's in general, at rest is very little, 10-12%, right? That's a, you know, half liter. Throw that phone away. Okay, now, when you train, each muscle contraction brings more blood, and more blood, and more blood. And now we're doing a giant set like you did yesterday. Boom, 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 and we're, shit! So much blood comes in the muscle, right? Okay? That's what I call hyperemia, is increased blood flow to the muscle. So I create hyperemia drainage system. Here is a training. I saturate the blood with all that I need in pre-digested state. Essentially, amino acids, BCA, creatine, glutamine, citrulline, betalanine, da-da-da-da-da, everything, right? So this does not need to be digested. If you drink a protein, protein is peptide, need to be broken down into amino acids. So here, you saturate the blood, this is blood, and you put everything in it. Aminos, EAAs, BCA, glutamine, creatine, everything you put it, right? Now, it's not moving. But now, as soon as we start training, the blood starts moving. And in the blood is all these EAAs, glutamine, creatine, amino acids, ATP, blah, blah, everything is there. Every muscle contraction open up cell is ready for uptake. So it is really biceps, boom, goes in. So you are putting all this into exact muscle that you're training.
Okay. 他这讲的就是每人身体内大概有5到6升血液。那我们人一天在做不同的工作，或者说在进行不同的活动的时候，这个血液在肌肉里面含量不一样。那比如说我们就在这坐着不动，它可能只有10%到12%的血液是在肌肉里面。那比如说我们去力量训练，大强高强度的力量训练，比如说巨人组的力量训练，那可能一组下来它充血就可以充血到60%到70%。那下面这三行字 have a mean advantage system 什么意思呢？就是它这个是它体系的一个学名，就是说它官方的一个名称。have a mean 的意思就是充血效率，就说让肌肉充血，那这个系统呢就可以简单的叫做充血效率最肌肉充血效率最大化体系。那它中间那个说的是那个曲线中间它写的 EAA 环酰胺，然后肌酸这些营养物质什么意思呢？就是说在训练的过程中，你每一次肌肉的收缩都会打开细胞的一个通道，这个通道就可以允许营养物质进入你细胞。那这个时候我们为什么在训练的时候不喝蛋白粉，而是要喝这些像 EAA 就是所谓的 essential amino acid 就是这个最重要的一些氨基酸，包括像 BCA， 就是它们是一个已经预先消化好的，就是说它是没有存在一个肽链，因为你蛋白质进去它是一个分子，它需要被分解它能产生一些氨基酸，就让这些预先消化的这些营养物质存在在血液里，然后通过训练的时候通道打开，让它们进入到肌肉细胞，这就可以产生一个最大化的肌肉增长。
Yeah. Do they know the difference from essential and non-essential? Yes. You don't know the difference between the sections?
So, you know the difference between the sections and the sections? No.
Okay, it's very, very important. Okay, what did I say? There's 20 amino acids, right? But other 28 is essential. Essential means that your body cannot manufacture it. You have to eat it. It's very, very important. Okay, once again, essential amino acids cannot be manufactured in the body. Non-essential, yes, like this, easy. All the non-essential body has a system of producing it, pathways to make it. But essential, no. You eat it, it's there. You don't eat it, it's not there.
就是说必需氨基酸非常非常重要，你任何补剂都要用，因为其实其余的12种生理是有一个体系的，你不管什么情况下，它为了保证生理一个正常的一个运作，非必需的氨基酸它都会，身体都会想办法把它生产出来，但是8种必需氨基酸呢，就说如果你不吃含有这些氨基酸的食物或者补剂，它就没有，就是一点都没有，所以对，所以说这个EAA是最重要的。
There's 8 or 70 plus 9. Cystidine is not, but you know, sometimes you're gonna buy and it says cystidine is conditionally essential. It's not. This is leucine, leucine, valine. These three are what? Those are BCAA, right? You usually take this, these are leucine, leucine, valine. But also lysine, methionine, phenylalanine, and tryptophan, tryptamine. These 8 are essential, you must take it. And fortunately, chicken, turkey, fish, beef, blah, blah, blah. All the animal sources of protein are rich with essential amino acids. And this is why, you know, when you talk vegetarian diet, is inferior. Why? Because they don't have a complete protein. What? Complete? They don't have enough essential amino acids. So.
This, 然后下面的五种呢，还有一种最后那种是有的时候会加进来，但是这些氨基酸的名字我记混了，以后过段时间我给你整理一下，发一个图表。就是说这8到9种氨基酸呢，很幸运的是，在所有的动物的肉类来源，比如说鸡肉、牛肉、鱼肉这些里面，它是含量非常丰富的。这就是为什么如果说到一个素食主义的饮食，就有点傻逼，就是因为它没有一个
提供这些必需氨基酸的途径，就是为什么我们要吃肉。Okay, so now on a point that he was trying to make, we use steroids, right? And so we're going to prevent. Okay, now steroids work at the androgen receptors, right? They increase protein synthesis, yes? Now synthesis is increased, possibility of increase is there, but there is no nutrients. So, you know, this is a little bit maybe complicated, but try to bear with me. Let's say this is a tissue, muscle tissue, right? And you want to increase protein synthesis of a biceps muscle. Okay, biceps muscle tissue, let's say here will be methionine and arginine and ornithine and lysine and let's say phenylalanine and tryptophan and cysteine and I don't know, let's use the tryptamine. For example. So, you know, I don't know, I just put things to the thing. But this is how it is, right? Explain. So the tissue, like a DNA, is made pairs of amino acids.
Okay.
那比如说那是精氨酸、亮氧酸，然后就一些氨基酸把它拼接起来，然后他现在要讲的就是这个，接下来这个肌肉的一个形成的过程。Every tissue, hair has a different bone has a different, right?
就是每种，比如说你的头发跟你的骨头，它的这个氨基酸链构成都是不同的。
Right now, you're trying to increase protein synthesis. Yesterday we did a hamstring and quads for Mr. Lu, right? This is how it goes. To create this, okay, you need to have a methionine. Well, methionine is here, essential amino acid. If he didn't have it, he didn't eat enough protein, or he eats so little protein that his methionine is going to be converted into glucose, it's going to be gone, it's not going to be available, right? So you can't even start the process.
就是说在蛋白质的构成的这个过程中，这个第二项的第一个氨基酸分子，这是一个必需氨基酸。那这个必需氨基酸呢，如果说你没有吃够足够的蛋白质，或者说你碳水吃的太少，它本来就，但它被转化成这个糖原了，转化成碳水了，那就意味着你这个料，这个氨基酸的这个形成蛋白质的过程中，它连最开始这一个起点都没有。
所以说根本没有办法形成蛋白质。Okay. So you said, you know, for me it was easy when I can visualize. When I couldn't, okay. So now I need to make a muscle. So how does my body bring methionine into the biceps muscle? How? There is a messenger ribonucleic acid. Yeah, okay. It's released in the blood looking for methionine. If methionine is available, boom, it signals. Now, transport ribonucleic acid, takes the methionine, and puts it right here. Boom.
他是说的就是肌肉具体是怎么形成的，因为氨基酸是如何真正形成这个氨基酸链，形成真正的肌肉纤维呢？就是说。 你体内，比如说这个必需氨基酸，它是在游离状态的，那你这个有种 RNA 叫做 mRNA， 就所谓的messenger mRNA， 就是一个转运 RNA， 它会在血液内去寻找这个必需氨基酸，它寻找以后就把这个必需氨基酸直接转运，因为它为啥叫 messenger， 就是它是转运，把这个氨基酸直接转运到你肌肉细胞里，然后让它形成这个链的开端。
Okay, so when this is there, next is arginine. Okay, so messenger is looking for arginine, there's no arginine, oh, there's no arginine, it's non-essential, body manufactures it quickly. So you get the arginine manufactured by the body instantly, and ribonucleic acid brings it right here.
然后比如说这个链上所需要的第二种氨基酸，它不是必需氨基酸，它是身体能合成的非必需氨基酸。 那现在需要这个非必需氨基酸是什么呢？就是说，身体它会去做出反应，去把这个非必需氨基酸生产出来。那同时，这个 mRNA 就又去把这个非必需氨基酸，转运到这个细胞里，形成它这个链上的第二个氨基酸分子。And
that happens with the ornithine and the lysine whatever. But what happens if next one phenylalanine, essential amino acid, is not available? Process stops.
就是说，比如说，它现在它圈的这种是必需氨基酸。比如说，我们这个链已经形成的很完美了，然后形成到这一步，突然这种氨基酸没找到，它这种必需氨基酸它没有了，那这就意味着你这个整个蛋白质合成的进程就停止了。Does
this make sense？
大家听得懂吗？听懂。对。
For you to understand why you need essential amino acids, because now the training gives you the stimulus and reason for your body to synthesize more biceps protein, but you don't have enough. You have a steroids, okay, but you don't have enough. You have a workers, but you don't have a bricks to build a house.
这就是他在这儿要讲的，就是为什么需要必需氨基酸，包括我们训练了以后，身体已经触发了肌肉生长的机制。 同时，我们使用六乳醇，那六乳醇它更多的像是就是建筑工地上的工人，它需要材料去把这个肌肉构建起来。那现在没有材料的话，那肌肉肯定是构建不起来的。Okay,
so for that reason, I was saying 4 grams of protein per kilogram throughout the day, and now my hyperemia lineage system that I'm pioneer of it. Some people know, some people don't. I introduce intra workout supplementation to the industry?
就是说他建议的一个蛋白质摄入就是每公斤提供摄入四克蛋白质，然后他这个系统啊，充血效率最大化的这个一个系统呢，其实是它是一个先驱，可能很多人不知道，就是真正的所谓的训练中等体系，训练前的普及，这个概念是米诺斯提出来，是他最早研发出来的这个东西。
So, I will start with a pre-workout shake 30 minutes before the workout to start saturating the blood with the creatine, glutamine, methionine, citrulline, you know, essential amino acids.
所以说在训练前开始的30分钟，它就会开始，就是会有一个训练前普及的摄入，来让血液中的这个像肌酸呀、谷氨酸呀。
So this, remember, your muscle is still not in a, I mean, your blood is still not in a muscle, but you just get the saturated blood, because soon you're going to be moving that blood right in the muscle. So first saturate, and then you make intra-workout that you're going to use for the duration of the workout.
在喝训练前补剂的时候，你还没有开始训练，你这个血液还没有很快速的进入到细胞内。但这个时候我们要做的其实是让这个血液里这些营养物质浓度升高，因为很快开始训练了以后，你一些营养物质就会跟随着血液一同进入到细胞。那在开始训练了以后呢，那这个训练中的补剂就是为了保证你身体内。
So even right now, at this stage when he's training, and he's under caloric, if he just adds this and this, he can save a lot of muscle tissue and actually build some just by saturating and driving into the muscle that he's training two times a day, right? So. He can be fat burning phase, right? But here, he can create anabolic phase and actually build some muscle. And then muscle, as a tissue, is metabolically active, so it will burn even more fat. So here, it's super safe to add, you know, carbs.
Okay. 一个热量赤字很大的饮食的这个备赛的情况下，在这个前提下，你只增加这两块也会对你的肌肉有很大的帮助。即使我们之前讲的那个，一天之中有这个脂肪燃烧阶段和韧带下的阶段，又有脂肪燃烧阶段，就是说你的这训练前和训练中的补剂，它让你这个合成代谢阶段肌肉合成效率更高，就可以让你保存更多的肌肉。这也就是为什么在这个训练中。 和训练前摄入一定的碳水是非常非常安全的。Okay,
I can go forever. You know, you find everything that is useful. EAAs, glutamine, creatine, leucine, citrulline, betaine, L-carnitine, and everything else that you want in the blood when blood is going to go to the muscle. Okay, so you drink this 30 minutes before a workout. You don't need carbs here, okay. But now when you start training, you're gonna start drinking intra-workout, which is gonna be 10 grams of BCAA, 10 grams of EAAs, let's say 2 grams of L-carnitine, 2 grams of betalanine, okay. And we are adding now carbs. Carbohydrates, fast. Absorbing carbs, either monomer, like glucose dextrose, or polysaccharide, like dithiargocarbamine, amylose, amylopectin, those are other carbs.
他这个讲就是一个训练前跟训练中的一个补剂的一个构成。那训练前呢，他写的这几项是这个必需氨基酸、瓜氨酸、精氨酸。 左旋肉碱，还有这个丙氨酸，然后在训练前的这个补剂，你是不需要， 碳水，因为现在还没有开始锻炼，没有开始训练。那在训练中的时候，为什么要加进去碳水？就是因为你在训练中的时候，你糖原是在不断消耗，它是要保证你的糖原是充足的。这样的情况下，就不会说去消耗你的氨基酸来形成碳水。然后这个碳水的选择有很多种，那他的建议有几种像麦芽糖。像麦芽糖糊精啊，这个还有一些简单碳水，其实说白了就是粉末状的葡萄糖，就是咱们药店卖的。
那个它有一个糖原区别的问题，就糖原区别，它不是4个小时以后才能区别吗？也就是你训练的时候，从文献上来说，你喝大量的葡萄糖是不管用的。还有就是那个渗透压的问题啊，当你胃部里面有足够的糖原的时候，你血液里面的血液和你胃部就会争夺这个糖水分。就会使你的胃难受，然后让你的渗透压的原因，你的二头肌的冲击啊，然后在训练的时候就会减少。这个理论上。
He's asking a Dave Palumbo question. He's saying that too much glucose during workout, you know, because he said that it takes 4 hours for the glycogen to actually get fully replenished, right? So maybe it's just too much glucose in the blood to make the muscle contraction worse or whatever.
There's going on RX muscle, yeah. Insulin debate. I talk to Dave Palumbo constantly. I don't want to call him an idiot in his show, okay? But listen, glucose is monomer. Molecule. Doesn't need digestion. You drink dextrose, this goes in the bloodstream in 3 minutes and peaks in 45 minutes. Now, what did we say? How much calories you burn in a workout? Remember what it said? 750, right? That's almost 200 grams of glucose. Yeah? It's almost 200 grams of glucose. That could be 200 grams from a glycogen if you use, or you don't want to, you know, use your glycogen, you use circulating glucose. Yesterday, the chest day, we had 150, right? You had 150 grams. Muscle contraction, you use glucose. So if you say Dave, we say like, what would that glucose do? That glucose is used in muscle contraction in, out, all day long. But what else does it do? That glucose is going to trigger pancreas to release insulin. Now, insulin is a storage hormone. So, blood sugar level, blood glucose level, 70 to 90 milligrams per deciliter, right? That's your normal, you wake up. Now you take 150 grams of glucose, it shoots to like 300, 400, very, very high. Well, hyperglycemia is toxic. So glucose causes pancreas, beta cells of pancreas beta cells to release insulin. So, as soon as it's hyperglycemia, pancreas tell beta cells produce insulin release in the bloodstream. So it's going to go and then lower. Okay, so now think about this. Insulin is taking glucose out of the blood. Where is the glucose going? Blood is where? In the muscle. The only place this can go is muscle tissue. Exact muscle that they're training. Okay, so when Dave Palumbo, Dorian Yates, or anybody else tells you something, okay, ask questions. Really? So what are you saying? Too much glucose is going to do what? 6 hours after the training. 6 hours still. Body's preference is to replenish the glycogen. Even 6 hours later. But during, okay, we call it anabolic phase. you dump everything exactly in the muscle. So if you color your drink black and blue, you train biceps, right after training, your biceps inside will be black and blue. You inserted everything that was here. And translate.
Okay, 他这个说的意思就是我们为什么要在训练中去补充葡萄糖，其实这个是一个比较复杂的过程。就说我们简单想一下，一次训练，比如说瘦的一次训练能消耗多少热量，消耗多少大卡的热量，一定要消耗750大卡，比如说750大卡热量，那750大卡热量就将近200克这个。葡萄糖了，那昨天的训练中补剂其实150克葡萄糖，那这个葡萄糖，我们通过训练中补剂摄入以后，它会引起一个什么呢？就那边就是 BGL， 就是一个你平时人身体基本的一个正常的一个血糖水平。那当你摄入这么多葡萄糖以后，其实跟你身体的糖原、细胞里的糖原储备，这现在跟那细胞里的糖原储备没有关系。就是说，你当你摄入一些葡萄糖以后，你的血糖会升高到300到400。那升高到300、400意味着什么呢？意味着你的一个高血糖的一个状态是对身体有害的。那这时候你的贝塔胰腺细胞它就会去分泌胰岛素。那胰岛素它是一个储存激素，它是没有这个目标性的，就说它不会去单一的储存任何一种营养物质，它会把你血液内所有存在的营养物质都没有目标性的全部都转移到细胞里。那你开始锻炼以后呢，你细胞是开始消耗糖原的，你肌肉细胞开始消耗糖原，那此时你的糖原需要去被补充，此时你在这整个这个合成代谢的阶段，你需要这些必需氨基酸，需要这些肌酸，这些一切的营养物质去保持这个合成代谢效率最大化。所以说这个过程并不是说一个单纯的一个葡萄糖的过程，而且就是葡萄糖摄入的过程，并不是就说你血液内的葡萄糖它并不是在单纯的去消耗，它是有一个去触发胰岛素分泌的一个功能。同时另一个需要理解就是在你这个训练之后营养补充之后的4到6个小时之内，你整个这个身体补充对于你这个训练过的这些肌肉细胞它这个补充的进程是一直在进行的，这不是一个单纯存在于训练中的一个过程。
It's amazing translator. OK. Now, please. I don't want him to agree with me if he disagrees.
Right?
Yeah. But I wanna challenge. Same like with Dave Palumbo. Dave Palumbo and I on an insulin debate. Oh, he gives his athletes GH and insulin together. Oh yeah, take both. Fire and water. Counter-regulatory. You're gonna kill it. So instead of GH is a pulsatile hormone, 17 to 28 minutes plasma half-life, very, very short, okay? Here, like you said in China, when you make GH was given to the undeveloped kids, right? You know, to grow. Lee Priest was one of them, right? So parents are instructed 1 hour after the meal, after injection you can eat. So you inject it and 1 hour you don't eat, or 2 hours after the meal you can take a GH. Why? There's no effect of insulin. This is why. Now he suggests take it together. It's like spraying it out. You buy expensive insulin, GH, instead of shooting it, you just waste it.
他现在说的就是大家知不知道那个有一个帕文博综合症的那个帕文博，就是一个他那个练到职业生涯后期肚子特别大，然后胳膊四肢特别细，就 就是那个人经常跟他争论一个问题，那个人他让他的客户每天早上起来，这个胰岛素跟他用的是长效胰岛素，胰岛素跟这个肾上激素一起杀，但是胰岛素跟肾上激素这两个激素是完全相反的，肾上激素是一个分解代谢的激素，胰岛素它是一个转，就是说它是一个转运激素，是合成代谢效率最强的激素，这两个是刚好相反，这就是为什么，这个肾上激素被用来治疗这个小孩长不高，就说发育不良的时候，他会让家长说，在注射了肾上激素之后一个小时内不要进食，包或者说在吃完饭以后两个小时以后去注射肾上激素。为什么要这样做？就是为了跟这个胰岛素的在体内这个这个浓度的峰值给它避开，这样才能让它有最好的效果。不然说他们两个一起打，你效果就直接就抵消掉了，就等于说你买了金赛的这个肾上激素，你直接就扔了一样。
Okay. Another thing that Dave Palumbo is advising: use long-acting insulin. So early in the morning, you shoot long-acting insulin. Long-acting insulin is in your body for 24 hours. It peaks several times, and whatever is in the blood, it stores, right? And on top of that, Dave Palumbo is ketogenic guy, has a high fat intake, right? So high fat means triglycerides. Insulin in the blood means triglycerides being stored.
然后他现在就是讲为什么我们不能用这个长效的胰岛素，因为长效胰岛素会在身体内停留24小时，然后它的峰值不止一个，它有好几个不同的峰值，那你很难保证你在一天24小时之内你的脂肪摄入都是很低的，你总会有一段有一些脂肪摄入，而且刚刚说那个对彭东宝那个人，他会让他的这个客户在做生酮饮食或者说零碳饮食脂肪摄入很高的情况下还是摄入胰岛素，就是为啥他不同意米老师，因为他的客户用胰岛素都变胖了，就因为他脂肪摄入更多，胰岛素它是没有这个靶向性的，它是把脂肪转入到脂肪细胞里去了，所以说他的会员就他的客户就都变胖，所以说长效胰岛素是
Okay. And now I want you to understand the power of insulin. Power of insulin. 2004, Mustafa Mohammed, like Mr. Olympia, right? He was using potassium sparing diuretic spironolactone, which means he had a too much potassium challenge. So basically, he was cramping up and he was about to die. They rush him to the hospital, right? And the only way they can save him, too much potassium, they inject him with insulin. Why? Because insulin takes potassium out of the blood. Okay? So anything that is in the blood is taken out. Insulin is pushing out. So this is medically to save his life, right? But I use it for my anabolic purposes.
他现在就是举了一个例子来证明这个胰岛素是有多强烈。之前有一个奥赛选手叫穆斯塔法穆罕默德，然后他那个赛前他吃了利尿剂，然后他又吃了很多这个就是说那个补钾的那个药物，然后导致他血液那个钾离子浓度特高，然后他就抽筋，然后差点死在台上，然后送到医院给他怎么治理，就是打胰岛素进去，因为胰岛素它把这个钾离子就直接转入到细胞里，转入到细胞里面，你代谢它就没有，就通过尿液就排出去了。这是当时唯一一个能把它救活的办法，也就是，但是米老师呢，他就把胰岛素这种特性应用在了这个训练里面。
Yeah, 3 days ago in the apartment, you were sleeping. I had I just my students on it. We talked about visceral fat. You know, of course, a lot of bodybuilders have that, you know, intra fat caused by stupid long-acting insulin. Idiotic coaches suggest, yeah, use it. Because there's no way you can get it out of it. Because during your day, you have a high effect. Triglycerides is going to be there. Insulin is not selective. It's going to put it in, including intramuscular triglycerides.
他这个就是他在前天 前天晚上他接受这个 RX Muscle， 就是美国一个媒体的采访，他谈到一个问题，就是说现在的运动员为什么肚子会很大？因为其实很多时候他是那个器官周围的脂肪变多的，并不是说他的皮下脂肪，是他器官周围脂肪变多，这就是让他这个肚子被顶起来。那这个是什么造成的？很多情况下就是这个长效的胰岛素造成的。长效的胰岛素，因为你一天之中你肯定会有这个脂肪收比较多的阶段，你脂肪收一多的话，你这些脂肪，因为你现在皮下脂肪又很少，它能去的地方就是说去到了这个身体内，所以说就导致你看起来的皮质很低，然后那个肚子很凸出来。
And I'm sure you've seen it. There's a subcutaneous fat, right? I mean, some guys, oh, they don't have much, but stomach is like this because it's mental fat. It's inside.
就是说，你看很多那个运动员，他那个肚子，你看他一去捏的那个皮，皮下没有什么脂肪，但是肚子还是鼓出来的。这就是其实他脂肪储存在里面。
So trust me, never, ever, ever, not even to diabetic patients.I don't suggest the long acting. I always suggest short acting.
就长效的药用，然后它进行的就是一个超短效的，用了这个这种超短效的药素。
And Humalog is very easy to control because after you inject it, in 15 minutes it's in the bloodstream. So onset, 15 minutes.
这种药素很好控制，因为它注射了以后15分钟。注射之后十五分钟就会进入血液。
Peak 45 minutes.
45分钟达到峰值。
Strong action 2 hours maybe.
然后在接下来两个小时之内保持强烈的效果。
Out in 4 hours.
然后四小时之内完全离开身体。
So before or right after, like you're gonna make it.
然后就说你除了这个训练之外的时间你需要用它，它只在这四个小时之内有效。
But during when you do this, magic happens because insulin is now pushing everything. It's dramatically more potent than naturally.
就说如果是用在就是训练中的话，就会产生非常神奇的效果，因为它非常强烈，它可以把所有营养物质都运送到肌肉细胞里去。
Okay. So, but I'm not suggesting to do it. I just explain because there's no need for insulin. But yes.And insulin, and I was always taking, insulin 15 minutes before pre-workout check, 45 minutes before workout. And then immediately, as we finish training, I take post-workout again, and then you have again that one. So you have for like 6 hours, for all the time that your body is still sending back to muscle,I'm doing like enhanced sending back.
他就说意思就是，他的胰岛素运用法则就是，在你这个 ，it's 45 minutes before.
Yeah, 45 minutes before training. You do it. 45 minutes after the last meal.
Okay.
And then after 15 minutes you take pre, and after 30 minutes you start training and take intra for the duration.
就是说，他的意思就是，在你训练前45分钟注射胰岛素，注射超短效的胰岛素，然后注射之后15分钟，这个摄入这个训练前补剂，然后摄入训练前补剂之后，再过半个小时，然后开始训练，然后开始训练，训练结束以后立马去再注射胰岛素，然后5到10分钟之后再摄入训练后补剂，然后在训练中。训练中的补剂也差不多。
Okay. Did anybody try?
现在有谁试过
？Anybody try it? Yeah. Yeah.
Put on 4 kilos.
Yeah. It's very possible. Okay. So, any questions about this?
这有什么问题？
这个东西会不会影响胰腺，导致我患上20分钟？
He's asking the same question that we asked you one morning on the session. Would Humalog influence the function of
action? Okay. Very good question. Thank you. 1,000,000% guarantee. Now I want you to think about it. and Dr. Maurizio Pasquale, Dr. Eric Serrano, and many others agree with me. If I give him 150 grams of glucose, or you 50-50 or whatever, okay, and I don't give you insulin, 150 grams of carbs is going to trigger large release of endogenous insulin. So beta cells have to work. Number one cause of type 2 diabetes, adult onset diabetes, is frequent high elevation of glucose, right? So if you inject the insulin, it's going to save your pancreas, not damage it. So if you're my brother, and I want you to be alive 100 years, right? And you are training, and you do the three intra, okay? With or without insulin, I will tell you, always do a little bit of insulin. Because once you inject the insulin, you say here, okay, you do the insulin, 15 minutes later, you take three, right? And then 30 minutes later, intra. So now, when you shoot the insulin, it takes 15 minutes to get in your bloodstream, okay? But in pre-workout, you're gonna take all this stuff, and let's say if you're gonna do 10 units, you're gonna have to take like 30 grams of glucose, okay? And 60 grams of glucose intra-workout. So if you inject insulin, 10 international units, and you take 30 grams of glucose, now, glucose takes 3 minutes to go into the bloodstream. So your pancreas is not going to have a need to release insulin because insulin is already present. So you're saving beta cells.
Okay. 胰腺细胞是在什么情况下受损？就是说你血糖一直都很高，血糖一直都很高，吃糖耐多，吃了糖耐多，你血糖一直都很高，它胰腺细胞需要不断去工作，它工作，它崩了，它就不能再生产足够多的胰岛素。那现在我们这个原理是什么？比如说你在这个训练前注射了10单位的胰岛素，那你在训练前的补剂里面又有30克的葡萄糖。 然后训练中有60克的葡萄糖，如果没有这个胰岛素，那就90克的葡萄糖就导致你的血糖升得很高，就是一种不正常的状态。那这种对你的身体是有害的。那你这10安优的胰岛素，它是把你血糖降下来，它其实是在减少你贝塔胰腺细胞的压力。所以说用胰岛素是绝对不会产生导致糖尿病。
我看过那个国外的一些文献，说这个很多职业选手，尤其奥赛选手。 都是要经常使用胰岛素，有不少都是二型糖尿病的，包括这次来黄金赛的这个罗迪·沃克尔，就是因为严重的二型糖尿病得了这个，不知道有没有听说？很多职业选手都是二型糖尿病。
He said he had read about a lot of articles about professional bodybuilders have diabetes for some reason and. Is it connected to the insulin?
Okay, I'll tell you. Growth hormone is diabetogenic. If you take growth hormone alone for a prolonged period of time, guarantee you're going to get diabetic. Physiology 101. It increases glycemia, hyperglycemia. It breaks down some polysaccharides in the vascular system and increases hyperglycemia. Growth hormone alone, growth hormone, GH, is going to make you diabetic. Insulin in conjunction can lower glycemia and save you from becoming diabetic.
这个其实就是之前他讲过一个问题，就是职业选手为什么那么多得糖尿病，其实并不是胰岛素，而是这个生长激素的滥用，因为生长激素它是会导致你的这个胰腺变得不敏感。 胰腺变得不敏感，久而久之它就受损。所以说，你如果单纯用这个胰岛素，然后同时你又在大量摄入碳水，单纯用这个生长激素，或者你又在大量摄入碳水，就直接导致你胰腺其实在受损。 但你身体还是需要一个正常量的胰岛素的，所以说久而久之久而久之，你胰腺细胞就永久的受损了，这是为什么他得了糖尿病。但是说如果你把这个胰岛素的使用跟上肌素的使用结合起来，其实它是在保护你的胰腺细胞，所以说这些选手他们不是因为用胰岛素得了糖尿病。
嗯
OK
那 It's about a question. Every time you use some hormones, okay, it's something called negative feedback, right? You have a normal amount of testosterone, right? And now you use more testosterone. So right now, this is your testosterone. More, okay? So now, when you increase the amount of testosterone you use, your testicles don't have a reason to produce so much, so with a negative feedback, you produce less. So your own endogenous production is lower. Same thing with the thyroid. There's so much thyroid, right? You start taking a T3, T4, whatever. So now you have more thyroid. Your thyroid gland is going to reduce production of thyroxine because there's too much. So it produces less, right?
他现在讲的就是一个我们身体内激素的一个反馈机制，就是身体内所有的激素它都存在一个 negative feedback， 就是负反馈机制。就比如说你现在那个第一个圆圈，那个小的圆圈，比如说是我们本身自身产生的睾酮，那现在我们注射了外源睾酮以后，你的身体你的睾丸它觉得自己不需要去分泌那么多的睾酮，因为你外源睾酮已经足够了，就导致它会分泌更少的睾酮。那同样的那个第二个那个 Sarcev 就是Sarcev 就是甲状腺激素。甲状腺激素不管你是用 T3 T4 的话，一样道理，你体内的含量升高了，它自身的分泌就会减少。
Yeah, that's
就是负反馈机制。
You know, you use more of some hormone, the gland that produces that hormone, you know, is suppressed. But in insulin, okay?Every time you eat, anything is happening with the blood sugar level, your pancreas triggers beta cells to produce it. Always. So imagine, 24 hours a day, you want to eat 10 times, or you're snacking constantly. It's all the time produced. But if you inject humalog, if you inject it, in 15 minutes start working, 45 minutes peak. Okay?Right here, now, brain sense the glycemia is in control. Exogenous insulin is lowering. There's no need for endogenous to be released. So, as doctor says, you are saving your beta cells from pancreas by using it. I would even go to this that, keep in mind,Number one reason for type 2 diabetes is people eat sweets, right? Sweets. I would tell an average person that is not even diabetic, you're going to have a big old pancake shit, like 200 grams of big old pasta, shoot a little bit of insulin. Don't overload your pancreas. This is as far as I would go. You know, because if you're not a bodybuilder, you're an average person, but you just like carbs,you're going to more than likely, you know, create insulin resistance and become a potential type 2 diabetic in a prolonged period of time, but, you know, eventually it's going to happen. So insulin, right, you use the exogenous, not endogenous.
他现在就是讲的，刚讲的那个睾丸跟这个甲状腺，它跟这个胰岛素分泌胰岛素的这个胰腺，它是有点不一样。因为胰岛素，当你每，你比如说一天吃十顿饭，你吃每一顿饭，但凡你的血糖有波动，它都会导致你的胰岛素分泌，这个胰腺细胞它都会进行做功。那现在如果说我们去这个注射这个通用，就是这个超短效胰岛素呢，它有什么效果呢？就是说它让你的胰腺细胞在这一段时间内觉得哦需要去工作。它并不是说在抑制它的分泌，因为你这个分泌是你血糖升高引起的，它并不是说你胰岛素的量增高了，它抑制了它的分泌，而是说 这段时间他有足够的胰岛素，他不分泌。那你下段时间这个 human log 离开你的身体了，你身体又需要这个它自身的胰岛素分泌，又有这个血糖波动，那你这个身体自身的胰腺细胞就会又会开始功能。包括他说，米老师对这个超短效胰岛素的信任程度到什么地步？比如说你就是一个爱吃甜食的普通人，你想一顿吃一个蛋糕，然后不想得糖尿病，那他的建议就是你打点胰岛素再吃，就导致其实就是。因为二型糖尿病怎么形成的？就是你糖吃太多呀，糖吃太多，长期你的那个胰腺都在非常高强度的工作，那你使用一点胰岛素，你其实是这个减少了它的一个压力，其实对胰腺是有一个保护功能。OK，
yeah， OK， so now I'm in the black because I have a big check. What do you want for a contest preparation? What is the ideal contest prep, if you do it correctly, what needs to be done?
现在要讲的就是一个理想的一个备赛所需要做到的，就是说有哪几点是我们最想要做到的。
So they agree. During a contest preparation, right? To be ideal on the day of the contest.You want to maintain or increase muscle mass. So people usually think, oh, there's no way you can increase muscle mass from your dieting. Yes, you can.
他说第一点就是在比赛那天我们要做到保存住最大化的保存肌肉，甚至说去增加肌肉。那很多人说不可能，但是在明老师那儿是可能的。
Yes, so you want to be as big and muscular. Second, you want to be super lean.You're going to lose all the body fat, right?
第二点是要皮脂足够低，要所有该减的皮脂都减干净。
Okay, so these two are done in this 12-16 weeks of dieting.
那这两点呢，就是在这12到16周的备赛期间完成的。
Okay, maybe next time you guys diet, next time, because now you already in process of the contest preparation, so you don't want to change it. But next time, if you maintain yourself, you know, fairly lean, then you do what I was saying. You have a fat burning phase, maintenance phase, and an anabolic phase, right? Anabolic, fat burning. Yeah. So if you do every principle that I was talking for the last couple of hours, you're going to slowly lose body fat.So, if body fat is gone, you maintain you know, all the amount of muscle, you are now in winning position. Now you have the last three things, which is usually a week before a show. Yeah, so what do you want? You want a maximal glycogen storage. Yeah? You want a maximal.intracellular hydration.
最大化的细胞内结合水的储备。
And you want minimal subcutaneous hydration.
这最少量的皮下水分的就是皮下水分要最小化。
Yeah, so all of us stepping in that stage in a contest, having all these five would be ideal. So far, you know, most of them would maybe lose too much muscle.
就说理想状态下，这五点都做到才是一个好的一个上台的状态。但是可能对于我们大部分人来说，都是就是损失了太多的肌肉。
So I think, this.Was excellent for all of them, and this was excellent for everyone.
就说他觉得，陆家门的选手，这个皮脂减的很干，然后水分也都控制的很到位。
Yeah, you very 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 good, very dry, very lean. Yeah, but did you sacrifice some muscle? Okay, were you fully loaded with glycogen? So, If you don't lose the muscle, beautiful. Now, last 7 days, it's a manipulation that we call glycogen or carb depletion and carb loading.
大家存在的问题就是损伤了下方的肌肉，然后再就是糖原储备，其实就是冲碳没冲起来，然后那最后一周要进行的一个过程就是一个糖原的过度消耗跟一个糖原的过度补充。So
glycogen, right? It's energy reserve deriving from carbohydrates, glucose. It's being stored in the muscle and the liver.
糖原的话是这个葡萄糖跟水分子结合形成糖原，储存在细胞跟肝糖原，就是肝糖原跟这个肌糖原两种，是一个储存能量的一个物质。So
1 gram of glucose and almost 3 milliliters of water is stored as a molecule of glycogen.
一克的葡萄糖跟2.7毫升的水结合形成一分子的糖原。
Okay, so now, science again will tell you that in average, men will have 500 to 750 grams of glycogen capacity.
科学告诉我们每个人体内的糖原储存的一个量大概是在500到750克。
Which is ridiculous, of course, because they take in consideration average 70 kilo men, not 130 kilo.
但这个数值是根据六七十公斤的人算出来的，没有把这个130多公斤算出来，所以不准。So
I do believe easily it could be 1,500 grams of glycogen storage possible, and of that, 70% is muscle. And 30% is liver.
所以说，米老师相信，很轻松的，人体内可以储存1500克的这个糖原，70%储存在肌肉里，30%储存在肝脏。Okay.
So let's say that this is a full glycogen storage normally. You always fill up full. But now he is training and he depletes like this oil with more, whatever. If you don't deplete completely, then body is just going to put it back into normal. The only way that this is going to work is if you completely empty it. Nothing, right? That creates now alarm, surviving mechanism. All the energy is gone. Now body wants to store more, supercompensate.
他说的就是，比如说这桶水是平时我们细胞里的一个糖储存量。 那如果说我们去训练以后，这个糖原储备量慢慢降一点，那它就会补充上来；降一点，补充上来。但是它这个总量不会发生变化，那什么情况下发生变化呢？就是说你身体这个生存机制被触发的时候，才会说它过度的去补充，就是意味着这所有的糖原都消耗掉，就一点都没有，就是所谓的这个 carb depletion， 就是碳水的糖原过度消耗阶段的意义。 你全部消耗掉，触发了身体的生存机制，那在补充上来的时候，它就会更多，就是为什么冲碳会冲得更满的一个原理。
No question? Okay. So this is very important, right? To store glucose, you must have a water. For transport of glucose, you need a sodium.
你说储存糖，形成糖原一定需要水分。那你去转运葡萄糖，一定需要这个钠离子。So
I know that many times that happens. You cut the salt, cut the water, and try to carb up. It's not gonna happen.
有很多人把盐断了，水断了，还想冲碳，那根本不存在，就是冲不起来了。Okay,
the body is gonna use up the glucose as energy, and that's stored as a reserve.
说身体只会把你冲碳的这一部分东西，拿来供能，然后剩下它就储存起来，当做这个储备的能量。
Okay, which happens quite often. So now, of course, the way I would do it, here, contest is Saturday or Sunday? Let's take Saturday as a contest.
Okay. But Uruguay is a contest, it's Monday.
That's in America, it's only, right?
Monday. So,
Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. In these 3 days, we deplete. You try to deplete each body part. So I will do the whole body starting Monday with the legs. You know, sooner we deplete legs, the better. You know, so to keep the cuts. So you deplete Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
除了这三天的这个过度消耗，身体的每一块细胞都要顾及到，因为你越早把腿的这个汤膏过度消耗做完，这个腿部肌肉线条能保存越多，然后剩下两天再把身体的其他部分安排好，就把这个整个的消耗过程做到位。Okay.
I don't go to zero. I never go to zero. You know, big guys, you know, go maybe 150 grams. You know, because if I train them twice a day, they're gonna be in 3 days they're gonna be depleted completely.
就是说他从来不做零碳，他更多的是，比如说像一个块儿比较大的，他碳水就是压到100到150。那像他没有这种训练强度，100到150克碳水，那一天两面就肯定是完全消耗掉。So
remember there's a protein, carbs, and fat, right? So I don't wanna lower the calories. No. If you lower the calories, you are getting a starvation mode again. You want to maintain the same amount of calories, so you still have the same protein, but because you're cutting down the carbs, you have to increase the good fats a little bit.
同时，这个阶段很重要的一点就是我们不想让热量去降低很多。你现在把碳水降很低，甚至说没有的话，那你要保证你整体的热量水平还是在一个合适的水平的话。
So if you reduce, let's say, 200 grams of carbs, that's 800 calories, right? That's about 90 grams of fat that you need to put.
就是说，比如说你减少200克碳水的摄入，那就意味着你要增加90克好的脂肪的摄入。
And I know that most of the people don't do it; they're afraid.
很多人不让做，他们很害怕会变肥。You
have no carbs, you need energy. Otherwise, that protein is going to now start converting into the energy, and then you're going to lose muscle, and you can never feel like that.
就说你现在碳水没有了，你供能的物质没有了。你如果现在还不摄入好的脂肪的话，意味着你摄入的蛋白质有相当一部分会被转化成碳水去供能。那你吃的蛋白质，它真正能用来这个进入肌肉细胞的，就说。
I increase water, I increase the sodium.
在这个阶段，水分的摄入跟盐分的摄入，你要是都会提升起来。Yeah.
On these days.
就是在这三天。
Now Thursday, Friday.
但是周五。It
starts carb loading.
周四周五开始冲碳。
Carb loading. Okay, now again we have protein, carbs, and fat.
还是有这三种要素，当然是碳水之后。
Now when you carb load, you don't really need fat. Fats are minimal. I allow some, but fats are minimal.
冲量过程中是不需要脂肪的，就是说他会允许他的客户吃一点点，但是基本上是不需要的。But
you do with protein, you lower the protein.
那蛋白质的量降下，你现在不需要那么多。
You don't need as much, you know, you can have a half of the protein. And now you dramatically increase carbohydrates. Okay, and how much? It's all different for everybody. I was, you know, saying to Lou that back in 2007, first time I worked with Dennis Wolf, I gave him 3,500 grams of carbs for New York. He was good, but not really full. Then I had to go to 4,000 for Keystone. He won that one, but I was still not happy. 5,000 grams of carbs for Miss Olympia 2007.
这就说到， 就是说冲量过程中每人需要多少克碳水，这个需要具体考虑的。他2007年的时候带那个丹尼斯沃夫第一次跟丹尼斯沃夫合作，纽约职业赛的时候让他两天吃了3500克的碳水，然后他觉得没太冲起来。然后后面另一场那个叫 Keystone 职业赛，他赢了，但他吃了4000克碳水冲碳，他赢了，但米老师还是不满意。然后等他上了赛的时候，上了3天吃了5000克的碳水，不是5000克的饭，是5000克的碳水。然后他2007年的成绩就特别好，很饱满。
That's so different for everybody. So I'm just saying, this is you have to learn about your athlete, how much you can push.
我需要了解每个人身体不同的一个特性。
Okay, so now also very important. Sometimes people cut the water when they start the calorie.
有人冲碳的时候直接把水就断了。
If you don't have the carbs, if you don't have the sodium, you can't load it.
除了你没有水分跟没有盐分，你是没有办法进行冲碳。
So right now, right, yeah, at this too, right? This is the only last day, last few hours. So right now, carb loading is this too. Maximum glycogen storage with the maximum intercellular hydration.
这两部分就是所谓冲碳意义。最大化的糖原储备跟最大化的细胞内结合水的一个储备。那最后一项是赛前几个小时或者一天左右才开始控制。
So to increase this now, okay? I think the best condition IBB Pro I met was Andreas Munzer. Andreas Munzer, he was notorious to have a super high potassium, okay? So he was taking potassium, you know, in Thursday, Friday, and also the diuretic, aldactone, spironolactone, potassium sparing, which is very, very dangerous. You can stop your heart. But this is what he was doing. And he was achieving crazy intracellular fullness, and then top it off, minimum sub-Q variation, right? But this had to be manipulated a little bit with the loop diuretics, for estimate, the methanine to take off what was left over.
他说他见过的上台状态最好的运动员是叫Andrew Smooth, 是一个九十年代的选手。那这个人他冲碳是怎么冲的呢？他在冲量过程中，他去大量摄入钠，大量摄入钾，大量摄入钾。钾因为这个葡萄糖跟水分子结合形成糖原，进入细胞有两个途径，有两个通道，一个是钾离子通道，一个是钠离子通道。他现在就极大化的把这个钾离子的浓度提升到很高，然后导致这个通道它这个效率就非常非常高，所以说上台的时候那种肌肉非常非常饱满。但这个是很危险的，因为你身体的钾离子浓度很高的时候，你就人会抽筋啊，甚至会直接休克的。就是为什么要用这种方法，就要结合像这个托拉塞米这些所谓就是它那个化学性质是环状的这种利尿剂，它可以把钾离子排出去，你就可以控制你身体钾离子的含量，这样才能说去安全使用。但整体来说，这是一个非常危险的方法。
If you take a strong diuretic during like Thursday, right, when you're supposed to carb load, you're losing water that's supposed to be stored in as a glycogen. So it's very important. First, store the glycogen, because when this glucose is binded with water, stored as a glycogen, now it's inside. No diuretic can break down the glycogen and release the water. It's not going to happen. So first, it has to be there. When glycogen is there, at the end, you flush out the water.
就是说，这个利尿剂，这些不管说是环状还是像螺内酯这种利尿剂，什么时候吃是非常重要的。因为如果说你在冲碳的时候就把利尿剂吃了，就意味着什么？意味着你把本身应该进入到细胞内的那部分，本身应该进入到细胞内形成结合水的那部分水分就排掉了。就导致你那个冲碳是不完全的。 那这个过程应该是你先把冲碳完成了，该进入细胞的水分都已经进入细胞了，剩下的水分都是在皮下的，那这时候吃利尿剂把皮下的水分排出去，那些整个又干又大的效果就出来了。
那个，因为我们之前有找这个职业选手去做一个计划，通常是在这个赛前七天的时候，先使用这个裸体脂，就是长效有机，然后在赛前三天的时候裸体脂不停，然后再使用复赛短效有机，然后在这个期间里面是一定不能吃氯化钾的，因为会得高钾会死掉。所以这个计划是不是这个方法？
He said that last year he asked the pro to give him a program, right? So basically his thing is that guy asked him to keep the adenochrome from 7 days out to the kindness, and add the transaminase or glutamine.
And
what? Add other dolorics.
Other dolorics,
yeah,
at the end.
At the end. So, he want to know if it's the right way to do it.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people do that, yeah. I mean, it's very, very popular back in like 80s or 90s. You do the lactone slowly, slowly. You see, Dorian Yates, myself, and most of my athletes, we just do it Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, lactone, 10 to 50 milligrams each day. But, it's enough. But Flex Mueller and the other guys from early 90s, you know, they even start like 10 days out and then, you know, 25 and 50 and 75 and they increase it. Aldactone doesn't react very good on everyone, and aldactone is potentially estrogenic. You know, so some people actually stop them out with the aldactone. I don't necessarily use it. To accumulate potassium, so insulin can push potassium, yeah, for that reason I use it. But then I also tend, you know, to have a super high potassium that you don't even need a lot.
比如说，最后有三天去加一点，因为但是他说罗内酯有一个潜在的副作用，它就会让那个肌肉看起来比较软，就会让它的整体视觉效果比较软。所以说，而且虽然说罗内酯它是不会把钾离子排出去，它会保持你这个钾离子通道的通畅，但是在一定程度上讲，你这个身体里不高浓度的钾离子又是很不安全的，就说你。采取不同的手段的时候，它可能影响到了会有不同的一些身体的这个，就说一些进程的变化。所以说它的方法一般就是，在这个最后的三天用一些罗内酯，但剂量比较小，然后在最后像用这个托拉塞米或者布里他尼这些相对强效一点的利尿剂。
用的时间短效用的时间，利尿剂用的时间，那压榨糖原的时间只需要三天，不需要。
He's asking the carb loading process must be done by insulin, right?
It doesn't have to. You don't have to. You can do it without, but it's much faster, more potent. You know, okay, there are always risks with insulin. Now, even in this whole thing, that one thing I didn't say, as soon as you introduce glucose and insulin, you inhibit fat burning. So when I was saying about this diet, it felt 16 weeks diet, and we do the insulin, okay, you prevent fat burning right there on that day. Okay, so yes, it's the only, for me, negatives of using insulin is you prevent fat burning, and also if it's anything else in the bloodstream like fats, insulin stored fat too, it's not selective. But carb loading, you can do it without it. I did it many guys without it, no problem. But I never competed without it. Since 93, every time I step on the stage, I use it.
不打胰岛素也是对冲它，但是说打了以后效果很强烈，会好很多。他有很多会员也是不打胰岛素冲它，但他自己从1993年开始就已经没有去，从1993年开始他就没有任何一场比赛说是不用胰岛素冲它。但是胰岛素对于他来说唯一的一个不好的一点就是，你胰岛素浓度，胰岛素在血液中浓度一上来，它会抑制你的这个脂肪的分解。 再一个就是，如果说你身体吃了很多脂肪，它会没有选择性的把这个脂肪转化到，就转运到你脂肪细胞里变肥，这是它唯一顾忌的两个。但如果说你控制的好的话，这种完全不会发生。
You see, if this is most important to be dry, right? If condition you are super lean and super dry, yeah, condition is great. So if you can undercard. You can undercard, okay? So, but you're not gonna be nearly as big, nearly as full. So some people and some coaches, oh, I just wanna play safe, I don't wanna risk, I don't wanna risk. You can deplete into the show, you're gonna be lean and dry. But if you wanna really be full with the glycogen, intracellular hydration, and this, then these are the things. Now, some people overdo it and spill over.
就是说，有的教练他更看重就是第五点跟第二点，就是你皮下水分够不够低，然后你的皮下水分够不够少。那很多情况下，他就会让这个运动员一直不冲碳，就一直直接一路减到上台，这样就是一个安全的一个选择。但是如果说到要让他。 上来的时候肌肉很饱满的，那肯定最重要是冲碳这个环节，要充足的碳。但是说，如果冲碳过程中碳水吃的更多，就会他老外经常就会导致一个外国人他经常说的一个 split over， 就是你的状态就变水了，其实就是皮下的水分变多了这种状态。
So it's a risk or not? But when you compete against the best in the world, right? 2007 Olympia. Dennis Wolf was not contender for top five. He was 16 in 2006, right? So they don't consider him. 2004, Gustavo Badel was not even top 10 contender, right? It's okay, you got a risk. And I don't know if you guys see the Gustavo Badel 2004, he placed top three. Nobody, the guy from Puerto Rico. It's not like politically, no way, he earned it. But this is when you push, push, push. But I had a chance to work with him for a long time. So normally, 4 weeks out, you test a little bit. 3 weeks out, you can test. 2 weeks out, you can test to know, oh, okay, this much carbs makes me full. This much carbs is not enough. You know, so things like this. So this is why I encourage you that as soon as you start dieting correctly, like let's assume after the first competition, and I'm going to probably be here anyway, I would highly advise, right, anyone, when you're super lean, then you really calculate your caloric requirement, right? Caloric requirement. So you put all the BMR, plus exercise, plus food, and then, okay, let's say 4,000 calories for him, let's say. And then put in 400 grams of protein, it's 1,600 calories. You use insulin, right? If you use insulin, you cut the fats very low. Then the rest, 2,400 calories from carbs, that's 600, right? 600 grams of carbs. And you create it. And I guarantee you, there's no way he's gonna put any body fat. Okay, one thing that I didn't mention in all this presentation, people believe that carbs convert to fat, Italian, right? Too much carbs convert to fat, right? Carbs convert to fat. Well, it's a clinical nutrition. It's called de novo lipogenesis. Humans I'm not efficient in converting carbs into the fat. Trust me. Birds, other species have that very good pathways to do it. Humans, as clinical nutrition is claiming, maybe 10% of total carbohydrate intake could be converted under certain circumstances. It's not carbs that make you fat. If you take a pure protein and carbs with zero fat, right? It's not going to happen. But when you have a protein, carbs, and fat, now protein is what? Amino acids. Carbs is glucose. Fat is fatty acid, triglycerides, right? So as soon as you have all, glucose becomes primary fuel because it's so fast, so quick. And glucose triggers insulin release. Insulin, we said, is not selective. So insulin is going to take all this and store it, including fat.
我快完了，这个讲完就要提问，就是那个，suffer，you can suffer。这个不行吗？这是pretty much that。